Thank you everyone for joining us this morning. My name is Tracy Tatum. I'm an Education Partnerships Representative here with the University of Arizona Global Campus. Excited that you all could join us this morning. Thank you, Justin, as well for assisting us in putting this together for your employees this morning. I want to introduce Dr. Newton Miller, who's gonna be presenting to us this morning. And I'm gonna put it on over to you, Dr. Newton.
Outstanding. Let me get my camera on for you. So hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. Whenever I start talking, just kind of clear the air. You're always nervous when you first start, but I like to say two things. The first thing is number one, I never take it lightly. It's always an honor to me whenever someone asks me to, speak or share anything that I have to say, because it's kind of like God's a comedian, because I know my upbringing, I know my background, I know what I've endured and been through. So it always fascinates me that anyone wants to stop and hear anything I have to say out of these lips of clay. And I never take it lightly. And I guess the second part of that is that, time is our greatest commodity. Once we spend it, we can't get it back. And you know the old song, time keeps on slipping into the future. Right? So it keeps moving. Time doesn't stop for anyone. So understanding that, I believe that time is our greatest commodity. And when anyone stops what they're doing to spend some time with me in any capacity, I count it a great honor. And I try to make sure that that I kind of bring as much value as possible, so that my hope is that you grab at least one morsel that you can take from you with this time we're about to spend together. So you can educate yourself, motivate yourself, and help yourself grow. And the second thing that I like to say to everyone is I'm super ADHD. So I'm warning you ahead of time. I'm super ADHD. I run down rabbit trails. So I always ask at least one of the other hosts to kind of turn on their camera so I can see their face, just in case I start running down a rabbit trail. And if I go too far, make a funny face and I know to get back on track. The other thing is that, man, because of my ADHD, I break all the rules of public speaking. I say, I talk with my hands, I go fast, just different things of that sort. I did a TED Talk and I bombed it. Literally bombed it. Halfway through the TED Talk, I wanted to quit. In the middle, because I tried to be something that I wasn't. I tried to fit in their format. So in these formats here, I'm just going to be myself if you allow me to be that. And I think we'll have some fun. And I think we'll both grab something from each other. So that aside, all the disclaimers, and that's just in case I mess up, that's my excuse, right? We want to talk today about leading from anywhere. So I believe that everyone's a leader, has a capacity to lead in some level of giftedness in which we are all kind of implanted with. So I want to talk to you today about how you can lead in your organization, whether it's in any spoke of any of the spokes on the wheel of your life, whether it's your employer, whether it's a community organization you live in, whether it's a family, a team, whatever the case may be. I want to tell you four tools that you can use that will enhance and enable your ability to lead in that organization. So I'm usually way more motivational. This is gonna be a little more instructional. So kind of stick with me here. So to start this off, we're gonna talk about leadership. So we gotta define leadership. So my four favorite folks that I listen to concerning leadership are John Maxwell, Miles Monroe, Simon Sinek, and Ken Blanchard. My fifth would be Stephen Covey. Many of you guys have heard of him. So John Maxwell, in all of his glory of leadership, he reduces the definition down to one word: influence, the ability to influence others. And in that word, one of the books that I recommend for you from him is an older book that he wrote, is called The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. The 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership. It's an old book. You can actually go on Google and just download like a sheet, like they have PDFs of all 21 laws and just a quick like synopsis of them. And I think you'll find those laws and those principles very impactful as you learn to influence folks in leadership. Another person I like is Miles Monroe. So Miles Monroe, and there's this book that I recommend, Becoming a Leader. It's actually a book and a workbook that goes with it. he sees leadership in a few parts. He says it's to enlighten others, to enlighten them and then attract them and equip them so that they can accomplish a vision that you see. So the leader sees a vision, something that needs to be accomplished. That leader knows how to attract and equip folks based on their skill set so that they can accomplish that vision that's being seen. So Becoming a Leader is a book and workbook that I suggest if you want to learn a little bit more about Miles Monroe's view. Then we have my boy, Simon Sinek. Simon Sinek's taking the world by storm right now, but my favorite work of his is, you got it, Start With Why. Now, Simon Sinek, when you listen to him talk about leadership, he really talks about how leaders inspire folks to accomplish the vision. So he reduces that whole idea of leadership down to one word, which is inspire. And Start With Why is a book I think you would enjoy if you want to go ahead and grab some of his work. And Ken Blanchard, long time in the leadership field. I believe he's from San Diego, actually. And if you listen to any of his talk about leadership, he focuses more on service, or that thing that we call the servant leader. And one of his works that I enjoy, he has a whole series of them, but it's called 1 Minute Manager. So these guys are old. Like, I actually still have a cassette set of cassette tapes of 1 Minute Manager, right? Some folks might be too young on here, don't even know what cassette tapes are. But the deal is, he has a whole series of them. And one of those that I suggest that you grab, and he has, it doesn't have to be cassette, of course, but it's called Putting the 1 Minute Manager to Work. So we have influence, we have enlightening, attracting, equipping folks, inspiring folks, and that focus on service are some of the ideas around what leadership is by some of the gurus in the field. Now, Dr. Newt, me, I see leadership in this realm. And what I would do if we were in a room together right now, what I would do is I would get you to jot down on a piece of paper, what is your definition of leadership? What are some of the key words? When you think of leader, what does that spark in your mind? So if you're at home and have a sheet of paper, you can go ahead and write that down. Or if there's a key word that you can think of that comes to your mind when you think of a leader, go ahead and drop it in the chat. And that will be fun to see as well. But I think of leaders as someone who has that ability to influence others so they can see what that leader's seeing, at least what that leader's seeing, and to help connect folks to the skills and to the resources to build their skills so they can accomplish that thing that they see. So me as a leader has a lot to do with education. I want people to see at least what I see. And then I want to connect them to the resources so they can build their skills and accomplish that thing. And the reason I say at least what I see, because I believe that the greatest accomplishment of a leader is to get someone to go farther than that leader has gone themselves. So I have 7 children, and my youngest son, he just finished his second master's, and he's been teaching for 5 years as a 4th grade teacher in North Carolina. He just finished his second master's to get his credential to be a principal in North Carolina. So I was a principal here in Pennsylvania, and he's going to be a principal in North Carolina, but I didn't start that work. I didn't become a principal until, you know, I was late in my 30s. He just turned 30, and he's already going to embark upon that. So that leadership, that's a win-win in leadership for me to accomplish at least what I see and move further. So I told you I'm going to tell you about these 4 tools, and I'm going to get to it. But before we do, we got to lay the foundation here. So now that we know what leadership is, or the ability to kind of see the broadness of leadership, who's responsible for this whole leadership thing? You know, like who's responsible? Is it the guy that sits in the ivory tower? You know, is it the lady over there? Who's responsible? Well, you got to get philosophical when you think of leadership, because each and every one of us has a gift. Each and every one of us has a talent, a skill, a gift, something that we uniquely offer to the world. Now, I told you I have a son, right? But he has a son. So there are 3 Newton H. Millers on this planet right now that are sharing similar RNA and DNA. My father passed a few years ago, so there would have been 4, but there's 3 of us, right? So here's the deal. I have a skill set and some abilities that my son and my grandson do not have. So I can safely say this, Before I came on this planet, there was never a Newton Miller that can do what I can do, the way I can do them, exactly how I can do them from my perspective, right? And now that I'm on this planet, even though there's two other Newton Millers that share my DNA, I'm still the only Newton H. Miller that can do exactly what I can do out of the 7 billion people on the planet, that can do exactly what I can do, the way I can do it from the perspective and get the results that I can get. And when I close my eyes and leave this planet, there'll never be another Newton Miller that can do exactly what I can do, the way I can do it from my perspective and get the results that I can get. And that also applies to all of you on here. That applies to Alyssa and Bonnie and Brandy and Brian and Brittany and Kathy and is it Shantaria? Hopefully I'm saying it correctly. Cornelius, Deja, Daja, all of them are on here. Donna, all of you are unique and possess a specific gift. There was never one of you on this planet. Now that you're here, you're the only one like you that can do what you can do. When you leave, the world would have lost a jewel because no one will be able to accomplish what you have accomplished. So we are responsible to build that skill. We're responsible to release our gift, what we have, into the cosmos, into our environments, in every spoke on the wheel of our lives while we can do that. So you see on here, there's a bullet that says you are responsible for and to, and I have two in bold and in capital letters. So I'm gonna use my children again. Like I said, I had 7 of them, right? So when they were young, I was responsible for them. I had to make sure they had something to eat, something to wear. You know, they built their character. They knew how to do the right thing, did their homework, whatever the case may be. I was responsible for those things, right? And oftentimes they did things out in the community, in the neighborhood, that cost me something because I was responsible for them, right? But as they became adults, I no longer was responsible for them. I shifted from responsible for to responsible to them. So I then became a mentor. I became a guide. I became another source of wisdom. I became a motivator. I became inspiration. You know, I became a rod or a pillar that helped them to define boundaries, but I was no longer responsible for it. Their electric that they used, they had to pay the electric company, not me, right? So the same thing happens with us. Who's responsible for us getting our gifts, our skills, our abilities out into our environments? We are. We're not just responsible for it, we're responsible to it, meaning that we have to do the work. So if you're waiting for your supervisor or someone at your place of employment or your own entrepreneurial enterprise or your family or your community to open a door, to recognize you and open a door and to create a thing and make that thing happen, you're going to be waiting forever because you're responsible for your gifts, building them, and you're responsible to them to get them in a place where they can bring some fruit, bring some harvest, and you can then enhance your leadership capacity and live in a more fulfilled way. So who's responsible? You're responsible. All right. So why develop leadership capacity? I'm getting to the 4 things, you guys, but hopefully you're seeing the foundation here. Why develop leadership capacity? Because nothing on this planet exists without leadership. Nothing at all. Every plant came from a seed that had a DNA, an RNA, and a set of code and instructions to tell it or lead it along what it's supposed to accomplish. Whatever it is that we have, whether it's a family, you have parents leading children, whether it's a place of employment, we have systems and organizations, organizational structures so that things can be led so that something can be accomplished. Everything on this planet exists because of leadership. Somehow the foundations and the fundamental of leadership are found in everything that runs throughout this planet. So why do we develop it? Because we can't accomplish anything without it. And listen, when you develop your leadership skills, you are sharpening your actual hands-on vocational skills. So to develop your ability to lead means you have to develop the thing that you're going to lead with, your skills, your abilities so that you can accomplish what? Your dreams, goals, and aspirations. You can impact the environment around you and live in a more fulfilled way. So I like to point out the difference between skills and character for folks. When you develop leadership ability within yourself and capacity within yourself, you develop your character. So often folks get character and character traits mixed up. They're very different. So here's an example. I go to a comedy show, right? The comedy show is funny. I'm going there to laugh. I'm going there to have fun. So my character traits that I'll exhibit at that comedy show are going to be open-mindedness to the jokes. I'm lighthearted. I'm laughing. Those are my traits. When I go, say, to court to, defend the project or whatever the case may be, I'm not in there with an open mind to everything that's going to be said. I have an agenda. I'm paying attention to the letter of the law. I'm serious. I'm focused. My character traits lie over there. Two different sets of character traits. Character traits are dependent upon the situation or scenario in which you find yourself. I'll say that again. Character traits are dependent upon the situation or scenario in which you find yourself. And when those scenarios shift, your character traits shift. So you can be intelligent or manipulate, negotiate, a better word, that specific instance in which you find yourself. But character, on the other hand, is consistent. It doesn't change. Whether I'm at the comedy show or whether I'm in court presenting a case, my character stays the same. We teach something in our teacher prep program, the six pillars of character, and some of the words are honesty, integrity, courage, discipline, diligence, perseverance. Those are things that are consistent about you no matter what your situation or scenario in which you find yourself in court or in a comedy show. So when you develop your leadership capacity, you're developing your character, those things that are consistent about you. And why is that important? Because your skills will get you noticed. You know, people will see your skill set and the things that you're good at, right? The things you can perform. And that will get you in the room. You know, that'll open the door for you to get you in the room. But what people are doing once you get in the room, they're watching you to see what your character is. So your skills will get you an opportunity. They'll get you in the room, but it's your character that will keep you there. So developing leadership capacity, it's a holistic approach to yourself when I'm building my skill set and my character that can keep me operating in the skill set to open up new opportunities for me. And then finally here, what's real important about developing your leadership capacity means now you're aware of the platform. You're making yourself seen and heard intentionally. Now, I know a lot of folks, especially if you're a Generation Xer, we're taught to be humble and kind of sit back and let things happen. So there's two types of people, really. You have climbers and you have supporters, right? Or servers. Climbers and servers, right? So folks, and neither one is bad, but if you're just a climber, then what you're doing is you're doing things so you can climb up the ladder, the hierarchy of ladder that's in your organization. So you may climb up that ladder quickly, and you'll get some influence or impact because of your position, but you'll then be what's called a positional leader. And that's something that Kim Blanchard and John Maxwell talk about. And a positional leader is the lowest level leader because they only get respect because of the position. People have to respect the position. But if you're just a server, then what will happen is you will give your gift. You will give your ability to serve and help and care for others. And that will be taken and absorbed into the organization, right? But you may not ever get noticed in a way that you are now moved up in position so that your ability to care and serve is on another level, so that you can impact and influence more people in that organization. So you have to have a balance between being a climber and a server, because you want your gifts, skills, and abilities to get in a place where they can influence and impact more folks positively, personally, as people, but also to impact the productivity of the organization all over. So developing leadership capacity is very important in those realms. So I took a lot of time to kind of put that to you guys, because if you don't understand leadership and why it's important for you to begin thinking of yourself as a leader and building yourself as a leader, then these four proven leadership tools that I'm going to talk about won't make a whole lot of sense to you. So in the chat, really quickly, you guys, there's four words. There's four of them up there. Can you please, if you've heard of any of these, go ahead and type in the chat which one of these you heard of. If you've heard of any of these, please type in the chat any of these that you heard of. I'm looking at the chat now. Regina, I like the fact that you said way back, and I asked what comes up as leaders. You said inspiring, equipping. Very good. I really love that. I love that. Excellent. Emotional intelligence. Okay, we have some folks that have heard of emotional intelligence. Any more situations? Oh, we heard of situational leadership. I like that. I like that. EI and DISC, emotional intelligence and DISC, are usually the ones that are most popular. Yep, that's what I'm seeing here. Emotional intelligence. Good job. So Shawnee is heard of everything except Inside Out Coaching. Outstanding. Well, we're going to introduce you to Inside Out Coaching today. Great job, you guys. Excellent. Thank you for your participation. Got some good, got some woke folks here. I love it. I love it. So let's go ahead and talk about each of these. Just give you a little things about each of these. So I'm going to start with DISC because I think this one is has the most potential to help you impact or be a leader from wherever you are in your organization. So DISC is an assessment tool. So it's an assessment that you take, and that assessment tells you about your personality traits. It doesn't tell you your personality. So if you ever heard of the Briggs-Myers or Myers-Briggs, I always say it wrong. That tells you your personality. It gives you like a list, NTSD or whatever. This is a little different. This tells you your tendencies, how you tend to behave in every situation. What are your traits? And there's four basic categories. We have D or dominance, I for influence, S for steadiness, and C for conscientiousness. So let me explain a little bit about this graph. Whenever you look at a DISC graph, it's going to look like this. So I don't know if you can, hopefully you can see my cursor. My cursor is going around in the influence quadrant right there. So when I take the DISC assessment, I am in IS. If you can see my cursor, I am really close to the I'm on the I side, just above the S quadrant. So that's kind of where I land. And I land kind of in the first quarter, close to the center of the whole circle here, right? So the deal is with influence, you focus on enthusiasm. You focus on the energy of the room and what's happening right now. So action and collaboration drive you, but it's really about the enthusiasm of the moment. How do we keep this going, right? Those folks that work are S's or steadiness. They're about supporting others, making sure everyone is okay. Everything's smooth sailing. There's no wrinkles. Everyone's happy. And again, collaboration and stability are their, you know, their side pieces, if you will, to make sure the support helps occurs. Conscientious or C's. So those folks, they're about accuracy. They're about the process and the rules and the steps, and it has to go this way in this order, right? So to them, it's the challenge of building a system or support to get the task done. And there has to be some stability so that, you know, we can be accountable to the accuracy that we're trying to accomplish. And then we have our D's or dominance folks, right? They're all about the results. Really, that's all they want to know. So what are the action that we're doing to meet the challenge so we can produce results? D-I-S-C. So I started telling you about the position of where your dot would be. So if you take a DISC assessment, you're going to get a dot. A dot will show where you are. So like a little dot on this graph here. My dot is right about where my cursor is. Hopefully you can see it real close to the S line. Down below the eye, I guess I should have put the dot in the picture, but I didn't. At the bottom of the eye quadrant, like towards the middle, about a quarter away from the middle to the right, and real close to the S. So I'm considering an IS. Why I'm saying that is because when you get to the middle of this graph, that means that you now have a blend of the quadrants that are touching yours. As you get closer to the edge of the circle, then you operate more purely in that D, I, S, or C. And you can be a blend of the two. Like I said, I'm an IS, but I'm more towards the middle. So I'm an IS, and that speaks to my leadership piece because results and accuracy or systems are important to me. But my tendency, my overall tendency is to make sure everyone's involved, everyone feels supported. And those things can come because I'm a Black male. I grew up in a time there were some challenges. I lived through microaggressions. I lived through, you know, some racial tension and things of that sort where I had to work a little harder, I perceived, than some of my counterparts, you know, and because of that, I don't want anyone else to feel excluded. So now my tendency or my trait is to make sure everyone is supported and involved, but we need results. So just to give you, I took a long time to tell you that, but that DISC will tell you these things. So here's another thing. A DISC, why it's important for you to use this and how this can help you lead from where you are is because if you take the DISC assessment, and I'm gonna share a few with you, then you start to understand yourself better. You start to understand your own traits and your own tendencies and the traits and tendencies of those around you. Then you know how to respond and not just react to the differences that you meet with those around you. Here's an example. I'm an IS and I'm the leader of our team. I have a young lady on our team who is a straight C. I mean, she's a hardcore C. So we're very different in how we approach things. So we'll be walking along, just use my imagery as a team, and I'll take off running. And I will find the nearest tree and climb to the nearest tree and look out in front of us and yell down to my team and say, hey, this is the way that we need to go, right? And as I'm climbing back down that tree, right, that C on my team already has 8 questions for me. Well, wait a minute. We're doing these 5 things. How are we going to have fine time to do the 6th thing? Well, what's the system going to look like? Who's going to be in charge of what? Who do we answer to? How do we divide the time? What about this? Does that coincide with these things? Where will we get the resources? That person will have all of these questions already for me. And all I did was say, hey, you guys, how about adding this on for our students? You know, just with an idea. So if I didn't understand she was a C, and she didn't understand that I was an IS, then our strengths would knock. They would butt against each other. So we need her process. We need her attention to detail. I'm a big picture thinker. I know how to motivate and keep moving things forward. I know how to map things to larger standards. But filling in the gaps and the details is not my strength. Not that I can't do it. It's not my strength. I do it secondary. She does it primary. So I keep her close to me. So when I get in these creative spaces, she can then fill in the gaps and make me consider different things that I would not have considered while I'm in that creative space. So instead of us butting heads together and her saying, you know, you're disorganized, it doesn't make sense, and me saying, listen, you just want to keep doing the same thing, we got to do something different. What happens is we, instead of butting each other, we open our minds and we fit together. We're able to synergize and work together because we understand our own tendencies and the tendencies of each other. So I'm saying to you, I'm going to show you some free DISC assessments that you can take. And if you can go ahead and look at those, it will help you to align and lead from wherever you are in your organization because you'll understand how you operate and how those around you operate. So get some of your friends to take the free assessments as well. So this slide right here, let me see my time. This slide right here, I'll go ahead and say it. It's a fun slide. So if you were a D, right? Say you're a driver in a car and you're a D, then probably what you're going to do is ignore that GPS. You're probably going to ignore the GPS and you're going to follow your own directions because you like to be in charge. You like to be in control and you want the results that you want. And when you see a yellow light, you're not going to slow down. You're going to speed up because you don't want anything to tell you, you know, what you can and cannot do. In that car, you're going to control the music and you're going to control the conversation because, again, you want certain results that you see if you're a strong D. If you're an I, then you'll probably forget there even is a GPS. You might miss the exit and make a couple wrong turns, and that won't bother you because that's more time to collaborate and help the activity happen. I don't know, is there any I's out there? Right? You know, so you won't even see that there's a yellow light. Like subconsciously, you know it's there, but you're not really paying attention to it because the journey is more what you're about. You don't care what music's on. You don't care who's talking, just as long as there's music and everyone's talking and enjoying the ride. If you're an S, then here's the deal. You know that there's a GPS there and you're checking that GPS. You're paying attention to it because you want to make sure that everyone gets to where they need to get to on time, you know, without any delays, and you want them to feel okay. So I got in a Uber once. And that I knew the person was an S because as soon as I got in, I had my bags. They said, oh, you're going to the airport. Are you on time or do you need me to go faster? Right. I said, well, I'm running a little late, a little behind where I want to go. So this person made sure that, you know, they drove a little more intensely to get me there on time. I knew they were an S. You know, they didn't. They asked me, what do I like to listen to? They offered me a bottle of water. They wanted me to feel well and okay along the journey, but they wanted the journey to take place. And our C's, right? They're going to watch that GPS. Like they're going to look down every minute. You know, the GPS doesn't say anything unless it's time to change lanes or get off the exit. If it's quiet and you just keep straight, that's not enough for that C. That C's going to keep looking at that GPS every minute, even though it's not changing. You know, the last thing said, okay, 80 miles on I-95 South. And, you know, you've just been gone for about 3 or 4 minutes. They're going to keep looking at it, even though they know they have 78 more miles to travel, right? So that's what that C is going to do, because it's about the steps. It's about the process. And that thing has to be followed. Accountants are usually C's, right? So they're going to stop. They're going to see the yellow light coming. They're going to see caution. They're going to see warning signs. And they're going to slow down and stop before that yellow light turns red. Those are some of the cautions that a C is going to have. And they're not going to say much. When they do, though, it's usually something very powerful. They're going to kind of wait and see and pay attention to everything that's happening because, again, the process is what it's about. So as far as DISC is concerned, I took a lot of time with that because this is something you can do right now for free. I'm going to make sure you have this PowerPoint. Each of these words on the side, understanding your personality to advance your career, DISC personality test and gain insights, they are all active links to free DISC assessments. I encourage you to take your own DISC assessment, get the explanation of your tendencies, and then encourage your workmates around you to take them as well, so you can understand them and they can understand you. You can then lead from that position because you know how to respond instead of just reacting and make decisions more proactively to help your teams be productive. Emotional intelligence, you guys. Moving on to the next one. A lot of you guys said you heard of that. There's the picture of the book. As a matter of fact, I think I have it. I got mine, my copy back here of Emotional Intelligence. If you need more resources around emotional intelligence, email me. My email will be at the end and I'll send you some free stuff that I have if you're interested in it. But in essence, emotional intelligence is the ability to kind of recognize and understand your own emotions, right? And your ability to use those emotions and manage those emotions so that you are not negatively impacting those around you. So it's about understanding your emotions and how those emotions cause behaviors in you so that you can better relate with others around you. Most folks stop emotional intelligence just thinking about how things are impacting them. But since we're talking about becoming leaders, you need to understand how things affect you and how you then flip that around and are impacting others. I'm going to look at the chat real quick. I saw some stuff going through. I didn't catch it all. Okay, excited to take the disc. Excellent. When you take one, drop me an email. Let me know what you think. I'm glad this is helpful for you guys. Yeah. Somebody said, I think I could be all of them. You're probably an IS then if you think you can be all of them. I'd be glad to hear that. Excellent, guy. Okay, so I said how well accessed. Again, I'll make sure that your leaders get this PowerPoint and there are active links in this PowerPoint for you to kind of go ahead through those assessments. So back to the emotional intelligence, you guys. Make sure I don't mess the PowerPoint up. There you go. So why is it important? And I'm saying this more for your leaders that are on here watching. See, emotional intelligence gives you a competitive advantage because you kind of are aware how others are thinking. So if you know how others are thinking, how things are impacting them, you can make decisions ahead of time to make you more productive for them. Very good for me as an instructor or a teacher. I can read my students, or if I'm in a service industry, I can kind of stay ahead of the game of kind of what's thinking. So it increases your job performance. It makes you, if you don't know what the growth mindset is, go ahead and look that up. But it promotes that growth mindset, which in essence says, listen, I can always get better. And if you have that mindset, I can always get better, then you're always going to get better. And the other thing I like to tell you folks is that people don't leave organizations. People don't leave organizations. Usually they leave people. So a lot of times, if you're on an emotionally intelligent team, even if it's turmoil in that organization, you'll stick around and you'll stick and stay because there's good relationships on that team. So again, if you want to lead from anywhere in your organization, if you're emotionally intelligent, then you tend to help that organization stay more productive and keep its people. So there was a study done, Forbes, a business institute did a study, and they showed that 60% of the leaders that took this study said that their performance was affected by their level of emotional intelligence in their leadership style. And they also said that 90% of their top performers would have an index of high emotional intelligence, while 20% of their lower performers had a high impact of emotional intelligence. So they were emotionally intelligent, but only 20% of the low performers were emotionally intelligent, while 90% were emotional intelligence. So it has some capability here. So emotional intelligence is broken into four quadrants, two areas. The first area is personal competence. And the two quadrants in there are self-awareness and self-management, kind of what I see and what I do. The second area is social competence. So you have personal and you have social, and you got social awareness and relationship management. So let's break each of those four down really quickly. So if I'm looking at the self-awareness piece, right, what I see, you know, what's going on with me, in essence, can I identify my own emotions? Do I know what I'm feeling, right? And what happens when I'm feeling this way? What do I usually do when I'm feeling this way? When I feel, so for me personally, when I feel belittled, when I feel like someone thinks that I'm not, you know, intelligent, they kind of diss me, if you will, and think I'm not intelligent, then I get real defensive. I feel like I have to prove myself. So when I'm operating in an emotionally intelligent space and I feel that rising up in me, then I have the conversation I need to have in my mind to say, okay, just stop. You don't have to prove anything right now. You are what you are. Just engage in the conversation and your value will come out in the wash. So that's an example of my self-talk that I have with being emotionally intelligent, with self-awareness. Self-management, on the other hand, is how do I manage those emotions. So I'm aware of them. So now how do I manage them so that I can get a positive outcome? Like I said, I'll talk to myself and say, you don't have to say anything now, Newt. You know, they don't know you. So listen and wait for your opportunity to interject and impact in a meaningful way, right? And it's going to keep everything moving forward. It won't cause any rifts, but you'll also add to the value of the project and the productivity of the project as well. So understanding your emotions and being able to manage them so you can get a positive outcome. The third quadrant of emotional intelligence is social awareness. So now it's not just happening to you. It's okay, what's going on in the group, which I believe if we're going to lead from anywhere and impact our institutions in meaningful ways, then we can't stop with what it is about us. We have to go into that, what's going on with others. So how do I identify my emotions and tendencies in the group? You know, what's this cake mix look like? What is it producing? And then finally, how do I manage my interactions when I understand my social awareness in that group? You know, so how do I interact in this group in a way that is constructive, in a way that it's positive, in a way that everyone is going to be operating on 10? Even if it means a slight sacrifice for me, to be the one to kind of navigate and negotiate how that group operates. So that's kind of emotional intelligence in a nutshell. And again, I believe this is a very, very powerful skill that goes along with DISC so that you can lead from anywhere in your organization. On this busy, busy slide, please forgive me for the slide. If you were one of my students in my master's class, I would have took points off on your, no, I'm just joking, but actually, no, I'm not. But usually you do slides, a 7x7 rule, 7 bullet points, no more than 7 bullet points, no more than 7 words per bullet point. But in this case, I wanted to give you some free tools. Again, these are all active links here. These are four tools that you can take to do an emotional intelligence assessment. So this fourth one down the bottom, Talent Smart, you can see the dollar sign, that one costs money. So the other three are free. This first one's 146 questions. So you gotta set aside about 45 minutes an hour to do it. The other ones are a little quicker, but it will give you some insight on your level of emotional intelligence. If you need more tools around emotional intelligence, again, email me. I'll send you some stuff I have so you don't have to pay for it. But this is a great assessment to take. Again, I recommend that DISC assessment and that emotional intelligence assessment, because these are the two things that will allow you to impact and influence your direct teams so that you can serve them and also help guide them to the resources that you need as a team to be more influential and productive in every spoke of the wheel of your life. Some of you guys heard of situational leadership. And the situational leadership, Ken Blanchard, has two components to it, right? So I know I'm giving you guys a lot, and thank you for hanging in. You know what? Let me check the chat real quick to see what's going on before I give you another one. Let's see. Definitely emotional intelligence. Challenging part for me, Kristen says, challenging part for me is teaching emotional and social intelligence to others. Yes, it is. Very, very challenging. And that usually is the sacrifice part I was talking about. And often that happens by example. So you kind of lead by example and teaching that. And then you come back and you circle back around and say, I was showing emotional intelligence when I did such and such and such and such. So excellent, excellent, excellent. I see some laughing there. Can I have your email? My email will be at the end, the last slide. I have an email, but it is nmiller@drnewt.com. That's the easiest one to do, drnewt2.com, or it's newtonmiller@uagc.edu. But it'll be on the slide at the end. I don't want to type because last time I typed, I like messed the whole PowerPoint up. All right. Excellent. 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 You guys, I want to keep up with the chat. So back to situational leadership. Told you I was ADHD, right? You following? You tracking with me? So that situational leadership is based on two components. All right, excellent. It's based on two components. And those two components are the level of development of those that you're leading or that you're influencing or impacting on your team. And that will dictate the level of support that you want to give them. Let's show you a real busy diagram here. So real busy diagram, follow me. So I'm hoping you can see my cursor. If not, I'll kind of describe where it is. Let's look on the right-hand side of the slide where you see all of the text, S1 through S4 and the D1 through D4. So here's the deal. You start with the D, or the level of development or readiness of the person that you want to help. Now, why this is so powerful for people on every level, usually on a CEO level, that CEO level person may not really know that ground level person that has their hands on the front line. They may not know, they might know of them, but not really know them. You know, their tendencies and their relationship. But the other person working shoulder to shoulder with that person on the front line, they know that person's tendencies. They know what frustrates them. They know their skill set. They know their weaknesses, their strengths. They know their dog's name. They know what they like for lunch. So there's a different type of relationship. So folks that are working shoulder to shoulder, I teach them situational leadership, because what it does is it shows you how you actually are a leader in every capacity of your life and everywhere you go. We're all leaders. And I can help lead my teammate next to me because I understand their level of development, whether they're a D1 and this new project is brand new to them, They may lack the skills needed to accomplish the project, and that's not a problem. But they might be enthusiastic, you know, to do the new thing because of the new thing, but they're a little hesitant, you know, because it is new and you don't always want to put yourself out there. So if I'm rubbing shoulder to shoulder with someone, I understand that that's that level of development or readiness, then I am going to operate in the S1 quadrant. I am going to be more directing, where I kind of define the role for them. So I take away that anxiety. I take away, you know, any other unknowns for them and say, listen, let me just break it down for you. We'll do this first. We'll do this second. We'll do this third. If you go handle this over there while you're doing that, I'll do this. On Tuesday, we'll come back together and meet and see where we are. So that would be a D1 level of leadership for someone. That would be an S1, excuse me, level of leadership for someone that might be in a D1 development piece. The same thing with D2. So they're a little more able. They got some skills now. You know, we've done it for a little while and I start to see some tendencies, you know, some I'm a little more willing to do the task. And there's a typo there. It should say, but I'm unmotivated for leadership, right? So they're willing to do the task, but not necessarily unmotivated. They're unmotivated for the leadership portion of the task. So I have a little more skills, but I don't really want to be in charge. I can do it. And when I do it, I get that warm, fuzzy feeling of success because I accomplished it, but I don't really want to be in charge. You know, I'm still kind of, you know, keeping arm's length. So you step into a S2 point where you're more coaching. And if you're listening, you probably can think of times where you've been the coach for your colleague, you know, and say, okay, don't worry about it. You're doing good at this and doing good at that. You're really strong at such and such and such and such. Let me just show you this piece right here. If you add that on, then you got it. And you're really that social, emotional support for your teammates. So that's leading from anywhere. So if they're a D3 or that person next to you is a D3, right? Meaning that their experience, they've been at this for a while, right? But here's the deal. They've seen the kinks and they've seen the shortcomings. They might even have met some, I'm gonna call them slaps on the wrist where they wanted to do something different, but were told no. And now their pride or emotions are hurt. So they're not willing to really take charge. They're really good at it and really have a lot of wisdom, a lot of good things to say. They could really change the system or the way things are done, but they won't, right? That's a D3 person. And they're going to do it because it's their job. They, you know, need that paycheck, right? At this point, you become an S3 or a support, right? Where what you're doing is involving them. So that they feel more ownership and more value in the project and that their voice is being heard. And you don't have to be the director or the manager to do that. You could be the person on the side that when we're in the meeting or sends the email to the director or the manager and says, hey, Susie's been doing such and such for a while. She has a really good way of getting such and such and such done. You should check it out. So then it'll be up to that leader or that manager of their level of leadership. And we don't want to go into that conversation of whether they pay attention. But you now have impacted and influenced your organization by making that known. And of course you got the D4. Now that's the person, I mean, they're locked on. They understand how to do everything. Man, you can kind of just give them the task, explain the vision of what you want, and then step back. They'll put together their team. They'll put together the agenda. They'll fill in the blanks and come up with a plan to get it done. So you move now into delegating. So here's a mistake with delegating. Often folks delegate to get things off their plate. You don't delegate to get it off your plate. You delegate to move it to the side of your plate so you could put something else on it, but it's still on your plate. So you delegate by staying involved, but monitoring. So now you're not actually moving the chess pieces. You're just making sure all the chess pieces are there and the board is there, but you're watching the game. You're a part of the game. So in essence, you're allowing people to operate in their strengths, to build their ability to lead and to make decisions and to make mistakes. And you can help them through the mistakes so that their capacity grows. So situational leadership, I'll say this before we move on. I think you kind of get the gist of it. Situational leadership operates like this. You're never the same. So I could be a D4. For instance, I'm a D4. I built the teacher prep programs at our university. So I'm a D4 in building them programs, making them happen, dealing with the state, dealing with our accreditors and everything. But COVID took place. And when COVID-19 happened, we had to find another way to monitor our student teachers, right? So I now drop down to like a D2, because I didn't know how to do it. I was willing, but I was a little anxious, had some anxiety about it. So I went to my team. And what happened on my team, that there were some people that knew a little bit more about some technology, had some different, some ideas. They stepped up to become the leader, if you will. So I went from D4 to D2 on my own team. And we kind of, did the seesaw, if you will, or the balance to support each other so we can get the project done. So situational leadership allows you to lead from anywhere in the organization if you're willing to follow that development and support paradigm. Here is that same picture, just a little cleaner, you guys. So you can see on the picture on the left, you go from a D1, low competence, to high commitment, all the way up to a D4, high competence, high commitment. So that's your level of development. And if you're a D1, they're color-coded. If you're a D1, then if the person's a D1, then you want to be more directing. If they're a D2, you want to be more coaching. We've all done that. If you're a D3, you want to be more supporting. All great teams have great supporters. If we're D4, you want to be more delegating. And you don't have to be the manager, the director, the CEO to delegate a thing. You could be the person right next to them, working on the same level, splitting up pieces of the task so you can stay more productive. Got one left for you guys and a couple of minutes to do it. Thank you for hanging in there with me. Let me check the chat real quick and make sure there's nothing I need that I missed for the inside out coaching.
Hey, Dr. Newt.
Yes.
Before you continue, we did have a question earlier that I thought I'd just pass along to you while we still have some time.
Perfect.
How important do you feel it is to develop culture in a business, and how do you do it?
So that's a real long answer to a whole nother session, but it is important to develop culture. Culture, if you think about it, it's a way of life. It's a standard operating procedure. So that starts with conversations about what it is you want to approach, which is why I like Simon Sinek's start with why. So you start with why you're doing a thing, right? And then you start with how you move from why you're doing that thing to how you want to accomplish the thing that you want to do. And then you talk about what it is that you're producing. So you kind of, to develop that culture, you flip things inside out. So I started thinking about a product. So let's take Apple, for instance. Let's take the iPhone, right? So Apple didn't start the reason that the iPhone is so successful and so wonderful, they didn't start with the phone itself and say, let's put all these things, let's create this gadget and put all these things in it, and then develop the process, how to do it, manufacture it, and then say, this is why. They started with their why. Their why was to innovate life and make life easier for everyone, to build connectivity and, and convenience for everyone in an affordable way, right? So that was their why. From that, they said, how can we do it? Well, let's create this device. Well, the device needs to do what? How do we create that device? So then they began to go to their market to see what folks needed. And then from there, they named that device and had a concept for it. So when developing culture in your organization, you want to start that same way. What is your why? What do you want to do? Are you student serving? Do you work with at potential students? And I'm just using ours for my program. So I'm working with at potential students that have a tendency not to finish what they started as far as school's concerned. So what things, how can I help them succeed? These are things we need to have in place, right? So if we put these things in place, what do we want to produce? We want to produce successful and students that complete. So in the middle of creating that culture, we had to have the tough conversations about what do you believe? So I believe relaxed deadlines. I don't care when you turn it in. I just need to turn it in before. I'd rather you turn me in a quality project than something that's just on time. Because I want to know you mastered the, the content. So those kind of conversations happened on our team as we were developing culture. So I could go on and on about that, but that's kind of where that is. Let me real quick tell you about Inside Out Coaching to kind of get out of this. So Inside Out Coaching started from a guy named Alan Fine, sports, and it's based on grow conversations. So in essence, say I'm a basketball player and I'm shooting foul shots, right? So Inside Out Coaching would happen like this. You would tell me to shoot foul shots and you would keep throwing the ball to me and I keep shooting those shots, right? And you would watch me and you would see the things that were causing me to miss, right? And I may not see them, you see them. So what you would do is you would talk to me and you would say, you would tell me to do a thing, you know, keep your elbow in and twist your hand out and make sure you point towards the basket at the end, something like that. And I would focus then on doing that rather than the thing that was causing me to miss. So in essence, Inside Out Coaching is identifying the barriers to success and replacing those barriers with things you can do to move towards progress in productivity, right? And you use something called a grow conversation to do that. So real quick, this is, again, where it says download the grow conversation here. That's an active link. So you'll be able to download a template to do that. That grow conversation is based on this diagram. So you start from the yellow, I guess that's yellow or gold, something like that, where it says goal, right? And then you go to reality and options and way forward. So you start the conversation by talking about the goal. What is it that you want to accomplish? What is it that you want to be able to do after this conversation's over? Then you move into the reality. So the reality is when, and this is the part that we don't like, where everything's put on the table. Especially if you're a manager or a director, you don't always like to hear what your folks are saying that you don't like. That's why this works on every level. So you put on the table, what are all the barriers? You know, I want to do this, but they won't let me do this because this other thing needs to get done and it's inconvenient for this office. And then they don't get such and such on time. But if we, you know, so you start putting on the table all the barriers to you accomplishing the goal. Like, what's the reality of the situation here, right? So that reality is not going to just include negative things, it's going to include positive things too, but what's the reality of accomplishing that goal? Then you move towards options. So now that you've identified the goal, you got everything on the table, now you start to kind of take over the conversation to kind of point the person you're talking to towards your options. So now you go through that list of reality things that are barriers and you start to engage the conversation. So how can we overcome barrier number one? And you get a suggestion there. How can we overcome barrier number two? And you get a suggestion. You kind of do that together, right? And then you, after all that's done, you ask for permission. Very important right here in this grow conversation. You don't tell them what to do. You're going to create an action plan, but you have to ask for permission. And I like to say, may I have permission to offer a suggestion? Can I offer a suggestion right here? And I stop and I wait and I make sure that they're okay with me offering a suggestion. And I now hear some of the options they came up with because I'm listening. And I can say, well, how about we move this around? And that will move that barrier out the way and make it easier for you to accomplish that goal. So let's come up with an action plan at that point. So that's your grow conversation, something you can use from any level. Set the goal, talk reality, get the options out there and get the options to the options, right? The options to the barriers, and then ask for permission so that the two of you can come up with an action plan to move forward. So you guys, that's what I have for you today. We talked about leadership. I gave you a definition. We talked about some purposes of leadership and why to develop it. I think we dug in deep on that one. We gave you some tools, I think, that are easy for you to use. I'm going to give you some links when you get this PowerPoint. You don't even have to pay anything for the tools. I love free, right? So DISC, emotional intelligence, situational leaderships, grow conversations, you guys. I promise to give you my contact information. My contact information is on the slide right there. I don't know if someone else wants to type it in the chat for someone to have it, but there it is. You can get my LinkedIn, Newton Miller, PhD. I have a website there and I have a daily, I haven't done it daily. I haven't done one in a few months, but little quick 2-minute messages. I call a minute of medicine for your mind to help keep you in a positive space if you want to move forward. If you need me for anything, please don't hesitate to contact me. I promise you, I'll contact you back. So I hope you guys grab one more so you could take with you to educate yourself, motivate yourself, and help yourself grow. And as usual, my friends, make it a great day or not, because that choice is always yours. Thanks for listening, you guys.
Thank you, Dr. Newt. That was fabulous. I thoroughly enjoyed that myself personally. I hope you all enjoyed it as well. I appreciate you all joining us this afternoon. I hope you all have a great rest of your week and weekend as well. Thank you, everyone. Actually, does anybody have any questions before we go? I know we're a little over time. Yeah, I don't want to count anyone out if there's any questions that they had for Dr. Newt.
How do we get?
I believe, Dr. Newt, we're going to be giving this PowerPoint.
I'm going to email it to you and you can send it to whoever you need to.
Okay. I also recorded it as well. So
for T-Tech, it's coming to me, guys. I'm going to get the PowerPoint. I already talked to Brandon. So you guys will have it. And it was incredible. Totally agree. I don't have any questions for you, Dr. Newt. I'm just absorbing all the information. So as it kind of goes in, I'm sure I'll send stuff up, but that was fantastic. Thank you so much.
Outstanding. And thank you for inviting me. If you guys need me, contact me and I'll have you back. All right.
Excellent. Well, thank you, everyone. Have a great day.
Thank you. You as well.